We're delighted to have our two speakers with us today, and Professor Grant Wacker is an old friend. In fact, Dr. Wacker was one of our speakers at the very first Faith Angle conference that we held in Maine, and so he comes with some history. But not only is he a historian, he is writing a new book to be published by Harvard University Press on Billy Graham and the Shaping of American Religion. I thought the book was finished when I called Dr. Wacker and said, Grant, I want to help promote your book because all your historian friends, Nathan Hatch, Mark Noah, both told me how wonderful it is. And he says, well, I haven't written it yet. And I said, well, then I can't have you at the conference. He said, oh, no, I'll come anyway and talk about it. But apparently what they had read, Grant, were some chapters. I thought the book was out this spring and we were just going to launch it like we're launching all of these books. But Grant agreed anyway to say that he knows the topic well enough to share with you all. Dr. Wacker has been a professor of American church history for many years at Duke University Divinity School. He, before that, taught at University of North Carolina Department of Religion. His PhD in American religious history is from Harvard University. I often told people that if Sarah Palin was not a disaster, that if she had done better, we were going to do a session on American Pentecostalism, and the best book on American Pentecostalism that's been written by Grant Wacker called Heaven Below, also published by Harvard University. Am I right? So Governor Palin failed us, but we came up with another reason to get Grant here, and that is his forthcoming book on Billy Graham and the Shaping of American Culture. Thank you, Dr. Wacker, for joining us. And please speak into the mic.
Okay. Well, thank you, Michael. It is a great honor to be here. As Mike said, I was at the first meeting, and when was it, 1989?
Or 1999.
I mean, 1999, yeah. And it was a long time ago, and yet it seems like yesterday because there are numbers of people here who were there, Michelle and David. And I remember sending a note to Mike after that meeting that it stood out in my mind because it involved people talking publicly about things that mattered from a variety of perspectives. And we don't get that in a lot of settings.
In the academy?
Well, in the academy, we don't. I mean, because there's, well, believe it or not, sometimes there's actually some posturing that goes on in academic meetings. But I thought that in that First Angle Forum, we found this very nice combination of public discussion about things that mattered and from various perspectives in a context of mutual respect. And so I thanked you then, and I thank you now. I'm just amazed, though, about something is that, you know, like anyone teaches American religion, I get invited places to talk about what's going on. But I never get invited back. And Michael invited me back, you know, for a second try. And so that's a miracle. Okay. And then lots of friends here and some of the journalists that I read most avidly. I have to tell you all, I hope I don't embarrass David, that I tell my students, both my divinity students and my doctoral students, that David is the best non-Christian theologian in America, and and so they routinely send me the links to his columns, and or as we say in the South, columns, and I say, you know, I get the paper, you know, I read the links, and then they'll say, yeah, but we want to make sure that you saw and read this one, you know, this one is especially good, okay. But when I look around this room and I'm thinking, well, I'm going to talk about Billy Graham and modern America and see Ross here, it is intimidating. It does remind me of an event that took place about 20 years ago and that I have never forgotten. I was headed off to Pepperdine College in Southern California, and I had, well, I have two daughters, and the younger daughter was about 10 years old at that time. And she didn't know I was leaving, and she saw me going out with a satchel. And where are you going? Well, I'm going to a meeting in California. What are you going to do? Well, I'm going to talk at a college. How long will you talk? And I said, well, I suppose, you know, maybe 40 minutes. It was a long pause, and she said, Papa, do you know that much?
So we're going to give it a try here, and if I run out, Ross can take over. We'll talk about Billy Graham and the Shaping of Modern America. Michael said the book's about Billy Graham and the Shaping of Modern Religion, and actually my sights are broader, Modern America. And that's one qualification. I tell graduate students don't ever start a talk with qualifications, but none of my graduate students is here, so I'll go ahead and do it anyway. You have to know that I'm trying to think not about Graham himself. We have some wonderful biographies of Graham already out there, and I'm not trying to replay those. But I would like to stand back and ask about why he matters and what his career tells us about American life. Second thing, quick qualification, is that I'll speak about him in the past tense, just for convenience. He's nearly 94 and in comparatively good health, but his public career clearly is finished, and so I'll just speak about him in the past tense. And then the final qualification is that this will be about Graham in America. There's a whole other story about Graham internationally, and I love to see some younger scholar come along and write that story, which is a terribly important one, but I won't even touch it except incidentally today. To this group, I probably don't need to say a lot about Graham's status, about why he is important, but I can just offer a few statistics to sort of lay it out and give us some sense of, I think, his magnitude, both on the religious landscape and on the cultural landscape. He has talked face-to-face to more than 200 million people, and that probably is more than anyone in history, with a possible exception of John Paul II. It's hard to know with John Paul II, but certainly Graham has talked to more than anyone except him face-to-face. In 84 countries, on 6 continents, and electronically, he has spoken to hundreds of millions more. Some observers say even to billions more. These things are very hard to document, but clearly one of the most visible faces of the last 60 years. He's established numerous attendance records, and I'll offer only one example. In 1972, he spoke to an outdoor meeting in Seoul, Korea. We have pretty clear accounts of how many were there because of photographs taken from helicopters, and they can count the individuals. And it's something like 1,400,000. So 1.2 million people at one time. And at that time, again, probably ranked as the largest gathering of humans at one time in one place in history. Again, it's possible that John Paul II spoke to more later on, but at that time, likely a world record. If you've seen photographs, they're easy to see, the photographs that were taken from behind Graham as he spoke to this crowd in Seoul, they're simply astonishing to see this this one man standing behind his podium and human beings spread out literally as far as the eye could see into the horizon. 28 books translated into 50 languages. On the Gallup poll of most admired man 55 times, far more than any other person. The next closest was Ronald Reagan at, I believe, it was 32 times, and John Paul II at 27 times. He even ranked on a best dressed list in 1970, which actually may say more about people's aspirations and imagination than reality, since he bought his clothes off the rack at Penny's often. But it gives you some sense of public image. I could go on with numerous awards, but one of the things, ways I like to think about Graham is in terms of what I might call cultural snapshots. I think that gives us a better sense of his importance. Harold Bloom, by no means a fellow evangelical, yet wrote about Graham in an article in Time about the 100 most prominent Americans, and the article said,
In America, you do not run for public office by deprecating Billy Graham. That seemed wise enough. Or Woody Allen in the movie Sleeper has this scene in here in which he's describing Graham to someone else, and he says, "You know, no, Billy Graham. You know, he was the one that used to double date with God." Now, that particular quip, if you want to call it a quip, is I think significant because Woody Allen, once again, clearly not in the evangelical camp with Graham, yet knew his audience. He knew that the people seeing that movie would understand who he was talking about and about why it was a quip. I love the children's letters. I've read hundreds, maybe thousands of the children's letters that come in, and they tell us a lot. Two, I think, are symptomatic. One, usually by children's letters, we're talking about first, second graders, and they're, you know, they're hand scrawled, of course, and one signs off. Well, they usually start by saying, "Dear Billy," they call him Billy, and then signs off by saying, "Tell Jesus hi for me." And it gives you, again, a sense, you see, of, you know, popular perception. What I like even more than children's letters are the envelopes, or the envelopes in which the letters are mailed. And you can see a lot of them in the Graham Archives or in the Graham Museum in Charlotte. Many of them are illegible, except that you can just make out Billy Graham, and they get there. They were sent mostly to the Minneapolis office, and somehow they got there, even when there was no other address except just Billy Graham. But the two that I especially liked is one that says, "Billy Graham, somewhere in the world." Okay. But my all-time favorite is the one that had a complete address, Billy Graham, you know, 145 Harmon Street, Minneapolis, Minnesota, complete with a zip code. And then down on the left it said, "In case of rapture, never mind." Oh, you can do this for a long time, but you get the idea. He received voluminous criticism. Some of it was merited, some of it was vitriolic, unmerited, and we can talk about that later. But I think the criticism's important too, simply as a mark of status. People don't criticize someone publicly or take the time unless they think the person really is important and really needs the criticism. Christopher Hitchens, after the very unfortunate event, which we'll discuss later, of Graham's odious remarks about Jews that were made in private, or he thought in private, in 1972 with Richard Nixon, and after that became revealed in 2002, Christopher Hitchens described him as a cheap liar and an avid bigot. And in another editorial, he said, "It's hard to know which is greater, his vanity or his arrogance." Graham received even more criticism from the far right. Bob Jones of Bob Jones University said that Billy Graham was doing more damage to the cause of Jesus Christ than any human being alive. And indeed, if you go on to just Google Graham today, I mean, just the oceans of vitriol will just astound you. And the greater part of it comes from the right. So, two questions. How did Graham achieve and retain that Olympian status? I mean, his rise is improbable. He's just a farm kid from North Carolina. Went to fundamentalist schools. He had no social connections to speak of. There were missteps, such as I mentioned, his comments about Jews in 1972. And yet, as one historian has put it, he became America's least colorful but most powerful preacher. So how did that happen? That's the question. The rise was improbable. How did it happen that he achieved and retained that Olympian status? And then the second question, which falls from the first one, and that is, what does his career tell us about America's career? What does Billy Graham tell us about America? The argument that I would pursue, try out with you, and working on in the book, goes like this, is that Graham followed the same approach that all evangelicals, or most evangelicals, followed. And that is, he discerned aspirations in the wider culture, and he drew on trends in the wider culture to meet those aspirations. The difference between Graham and most evangelicals is that he did it with dramatically greater skill for 6 decades and with remarkably few missteps. There were missteps, but comparatively very few. So, let me put the argument in a few slightly different terms. He did not create those trends, but he discerned trends that were already there. And then he appropriated them and shaped them, and he applied them for his own purposes. The results were numerous initiated projects. Sometimes he legitimated broad outlooks. Sometimes he shaped public discourse. The key point is that in a lot of ways, he was both a product and a producer of the times, both a product of the culture and a shaper of the culture. He registered the times and he molded the times. And that's why I think he's important. I am working on a series of case studies that I hope will make this point, and I'll try to do this very briefly. We can outline and we can talk about them in far greater detail. But one case study will involve Graham as Heartlander. And herein I think that he appropriated and shaped and applied or deployed the values that we associate with Heartland America. And just a very few. His parents, he wrote autobiographically a lot, and he wrote about his parents who were Southern Presbyterians, conservative, mainstream, and here the important point is they were not snake handlers. They were not dispensationalist fundamentalists, at least initially, and they present this image of stable, solid, Southern evangelical mainline. When Graham wrote about himself and his autobiography and countless interviews, I mean, just vast number of interviews. He wrote about his youth in terms of being a red-blooded American adolescent male, fast cars, sports, baseball, pretty girls. Presented himself as just, you know, a down-home guy, appealed to those kinds of values. Unbuttoned, neighborly style comes through. Traditional ideas about gender, about manliness, and by traditional, I mean not extreme to the left, not extreme to the right, but just that, traditional views of gender and what it means to be a man. And he also maintained impeccable personal integrity throughout his life, in terms of his marital fidelity, in terms of his financial affairs, in terms of truthfulness. And all of this played to American assumptions of their own heartland values. Bill Martin is the best biography of Billy Graham, and he says what Americans saw in Billy Graham was their best selves. Whether or not they maintained marital fidelity and financial integrity and public truthfulness in their own lives, they yet esteemed someone who did it for them.